hello there, and welcome to this week's broadcast. I am Anne LaFollette, and I'm super excited to continue our conversation about how to start your creative business. In last week's broadcast, I covered the first five of the 10 steps that I recommend you follow in order to get started building a business. And those five steps were covered in detail last week. So if you missed them, watch last week's video here on YouTube. And this week, I'm going to cover the next of the steps. So steps 6 through 10. So let's just get started. Step number 6 is setting up a simple website. And my biggest piece of advice about a website is that you can really go down a rabbit hole when you start to think about a website. You can think about how pretty you want it to be. You can think about a whole bunch of content you want to have housed on it. And it actually is important to keep it very simple in the beginning because you can always make it more complicated later. And the purpose of a website, especially when you're starting out, is really to attract your ideal customer so that your ideal customer knows where to go to learn more about you and also knows where to find the content that you're going to be providing to them, which I'm going to talk about in one of the next steps. So there are really five basic things that you want to make sure you have on your website. And the first of those is you want to make sure that when people come onto your website, they immediately know what it is that you do. So you need a nice tagline, or you need to make sure your actual business name reflects what it is that you do. Or if you're using your own personal name like I am, it's Anne LaFollette Art, you need to make sure that there is an about section that talks about what it is that you do. The second most important thing is as soon as someone lands on your website, you really want them to be able to come on to your email list. And we talked about the importance of an email list last week. So it's important that they be able to find your opt-in or your lead magnet, and you want to have that throughout your website. The third thing you want to make sure you have is if you already are offering either programs or services, you want to make sure those are outlined really clearly so people can understand what they can buy from you and what those services entail. The next thing is if you have students already, you want to be able to share some testimonials or some stories about their success, which validates the fact that the programs and services that you're providing are really, really valuable and that people have already had experience with them. Now, when you're starting out, you won't have those. So you're going to want to talk about your own personal experience because that is what is going to validate your story and validate what it is that you're offering to your customers. And then finally, you want to make sure that you either have a tag that says blog or your podcast or your video show, whatever the content is that you're going to be providing. And I'm actually going to talk about that next. So step number 7 is delivering valuable content to this community that you're building. And there really are three things to keep in mind when you're thinking about this content. The first is, well, what is the content that you want to share with people? The second thing is that going to be in the form of a blog or a podcast or a video show? And then finally, with what kind of frequency and consistency are you going to deliver that? So let me take those a little bit sort of one by one. Now, the reason that you want to be providing content to your community is as they come onto your email list, you want to continue to communicate with them. You have given them something valuable, the opt-in or the lead magnet that we talked about last week. They're now on your email list, and so they're expecting to hear from you. So what I did in my first year in business when I was growing my business is I would blog every week. And so when you go on my website, there's a blog handle and you can go in there and you can now read. I blogged every single week and I still do blog every single week. Now, if you don't like to write, then that's not a good choice for you. You should pick something else, like a video show or a podcast perhaps. And one of the things that's really great to keep in mind is that even if you're not comfortable on video at the beginning, you will be by virtue of doing it over and over again. So I want to make sure that what you pick is something that you're truly going to love. So I actually kind of like to write, and so it was also fun for me to write because I could embed imagery into my blogs, which I still do. But then after a year, I realized, you know, people actually really prefer to watch videos. There's way more video views in the world today than blog readers. So I started to extend, like I'm doing right now, with a video and with my YouTube channel. And so I will post my blog in written format for people who still like to read. Then I'll record it just like I am right now to tell you about what's in that blog and talk to you specifically about these next 5 steps in my 10-step process. And then eventually I might decide that I want to do a podcast as well. But the most important thing is for you to just pick one of those things, either a podcast, a video show, like to be on YouTube, or a blog. And it has to be something that you're gonna enjoy doing, and then you have to then pick the frequency. You could just start out once a month if you want. You could do it every other week. You are gonna have to decide, but I think that the consistency piece is very, very important because we're in this for the long game. All right, so that is step number 7. Step number 8 is community. And you might ask, well, why am I mentioning community as a part of the 10 steps to start your creative business? And the reason being is I think, again, when someone joins your email list and you start to communicate them with them, it would be great for them to also have an online community where they can meet other people who've joined your email list, where you can pop on periodically and either post or go live on video. And so Facebook is a really great place for this. It's an incredible place to build community. It's an incredible place to find your community, and it's an amazing place to communicate directly with your community. So I highly recommend it. And for those of you who are already in my community, you know when you got emails from me, I would frequently remind you, please come into my free Facebook community that's called Anne's Art Club. I ask you a couple of questions that you have to fill out before I'll let you in, because I want to make sure that the people who are coming into the community are the people who make sense to be there, and in particular are interested in a creative journey and in surface pattern design in particular. But it's a great place for then you to get to know each other and for me to communicate with you. And so building that community is really, really important. And even though it's an online community, it still is a very, very strong personal connection between me and you, and you and the rest of the group. So step number 9 is one that is probably nearest and dearest to my heart, and that is figuring out how to develop multiple income streams. I am a big believer that you don't want to put all your eggs in one basket. So even though you might be super passionate about putting your designs onto fabric, and as a result might want to go down the licensing route, it still would behoove you to think about other ways you're also going to be able to make money from your art in order to create a more diverse portfolio of how money comes into your business. So I have sort of 4 different categories to talk about. And I'll keep it at a fairly high level, but there's additional detail actually in the written blog post if you pop over to annelafolletart.com/blog. And the 4 categories are direct selling options, indirect selling options, teaching, and potentially having a membership. So let me talk about those a little bit. Direct selling means that you would actually purchase some of your, or have manufactured some of your own products, and then you would resell those to the general public. So for example, once a year I do a fair during the holidays. I've purchased a bunch of my own products and I resell those to the general public at a holiday craft market. That's one way of selling directly. You can also sell directly from your website. So you basically, on your website, you have a little shop category, and then you upload images of everything that you have available, and then people can purchase them through the website, and then you have to ship them all out. So that's direct. You're making direct contact with your customer. The money's coming in, you're shipping them something directly. And what's great about that option is, even though there's workload associated with it and costs associated with it, is that you can totally curate the experience your customer has when the package arrives. And what I mean by that is you can pick the box. You can pick the tissue paper that might have one of your beautiful designs on it. You can make sure that there's a personalized note inside. And you might also give them some other little freebie that's inside. So that's what direct selling looks like. Indirect selling is more putting your designs up on sites like Society6, which is a print-on-demand site. You can Google print-on-demand sites. There are many, many, many choices. Some do hard goods like iPhone cases, laptop skins, mugs, journals, and on and on and on and on. Others are, which is Society 6, which has, I think, over 50 products now that you can put your designs on. Then there are others like Zazzle, which is more in the fabric category, where you can do scarves and t-shirts and a variety of other products that fall into that apparel category. So lots and lots of options. They're great for a couple different reasons. One, they're great because you can actually purchase small quantities of your own products on sale with a designer discount once you have your shop set up. And the other thing is, it's totally passive income. So once you tell people about it and then you market it and you make sure that people know you have new designs on these sites, you get 10% of the proceeds whenever something's sold. Now, it's very indirect. You don't actually know who purchased from you. You don't get information on the customer. And the reason you get 10% and those firms keep 90% is because they're manufacturing everything, they're shipping everything, they are handling all of the returns, they're also handling all of the money exchange, and they are providing you with the infrastructure, all of the infrastructure. And so 10% might not sound like a lot, but at the end of the day, it's totally passive. All you're doing is uploading a design, picking the products you think it will look beautiful on, and then you're done in that design, and those products are there forever. So that is indirect selling. Now, teaching is a category that I don't want people to ignore, because in today's world, there is so much education happening online. There's really a knowledge revolution happening in the online space, not only free with YouTube, but also paid with online courses. And so if there's something that you love to do that's in the creative space or even in the non-creative space, if you had a long career in a particular industry and you can then monetize that knowledge in an online course, you can make money that way that can then fund your creative business. Or if you're doing something that you absolutely love creatively, like I am, surface design, I sell courses on how to do surface pattern design. And so I am using my knowledge and my passion and teaching it online. So teaching is a great place to explore. I teach on Skillshare, and you can check out my latest class there, which is what I learned in my first year teaching on Skillshare, which could be very educational for you. And there is a free link in the video description to get 2 months free if you're not currently a member of Skillshare. If you come through my teacher link, I can give you 2 months free. Then the last thing I wanted to mention was memberships. And so you might actually develop a community that really does want to actually talk to each other, and where you want to deliver valuable content, and you actually want it to be a paid type of an arrangement. You might have a free Facebook group, and then you might have a paid Facebook group where people actually are going to pay you based on what you're going to be providing to them either every week or every month, that creates a membership environment. It could be a community type of a membership, or it could be a really kind of a course, almost like a course where you're teaching every week. There are lots and lots of variety and lots of choices that fall under the membership category. But the reason memberships are good to consider is because once someone signs up for a membership, just like your Netflix subscription, you get that money every month until someone cancels. So it's another great way to just think about the economics of your business, as well as different ways in which you can actually be bringing money into your creative business. So finally, step number 10 is licensing. And licensing is really a category all by itself. It's much, there are many steps involved in going down the licensing route. It's a fantastic option. I just am putting it as its own step because it's fairly involved and there are a variety of steps you need to follow. It really could be a course in and of itself, and it certainly could be a whole blog post in and of itself. But in a nutshell, if you want to be licensed, you're going to pick an industry, many different industries for you to license in. You can license in the fabric industry, or in the stationery industry, or in the home goods industry. Lots and lots of choices. You need to have a portfolio to show the companies that you are interested in, and you need to research the companies you think that you would be the best fit for. And then there's trade shows for you to explore, to develop relationships with companies. Then there are art directors you're going to need to figure out, like, well, who they are and how to get a hold of them and how to get your portfolio in their hands. And then there's the whole contract piece. Once the company expresses interest in you, negotiating your contract and ensuring that you have a lawyer who can look over all the paperwork and make sure that it's structured properly for you. And then you actually start to deliver work to them, and eventually you get paid. So I hope that this has been helpful. I know it's a lot of content. The intent was really to share with you the benefit of my experience now that I'm sort of 2.5, almost 3 years into my creative business, and to try to outline in sort of broad strokes what it is that's required, so you have a bit of a roadmap. If you enjoyed this video and you enjoy what I cover here on my YouTube channel, don't forget to subscribe. I would really appreciate it. And hit the little bell so that you are notified when I have a new video available. Don't forget to download the PDF guide. This is a 20-page document PDF that I created for you. If you download it and keep it online, you can click through to all of the clickable links that send you to additional resources that I mention in the 10 steps. And I'd want to make sure that you grab it. And I always like to say in closing that I am Ann LaFollette, and it's never too late to create. Bye for now, and I'll see you again next week.